Hello there. Well, it's Sunday morning and we're here at the Tavern by the Sea, which is part of the Amare in North Pattaya, right on the beach. And of course, we're here for the Pattaya City Expats Club. They meet every Sunday morning. It's a great way to meet expats and to actually get a background of what's going on in Pattaya and what went on before. Now, the lady that I'm going to interview today is a member of the Pattaya City Expats Club, but she's also the guest speaker today. It's Pat Koester. Pat. Now, Pat, your subject today was U-Tapao International Airport. Now, many times on TV, I've said, oh, you know, Pattaya was once a fishing village and it was a stopping off point for the American servicemen on their R&R. This is where U-Tapao, where your life and U-Tapao all comes together. Tell us what U-Tapao means to you and where it started.
Okay. Well, actually, my talk was about U-Tapao Royal Thai Navy Airfield. Because what people don't realize is that the airport is just a very small part of this much larger military base. And during the Vietnam War, the Thai Navy allowed the United States Air Force to have about 7,000 men and 32 women stationed there. And they had there were several bases around Thailand, actually, where they had the U.S. Air Force, but all the others had fighter planes, and here they had the B-52.
Okay. Now, I think even a lot of people know that the U-Tapao, it's got one of the longest runways, I believe, in Thailand. Is that correct?
Yes, as I understand. Huh?
And is that why that it would have been particularly significant and appropriate for the American?
Well, actually, the Americans built the runway there. It was built for the B-52. The B-52 is almost as big as a 747.
Now, today you showed a number of great slides and some wonderful video clips.
Thank you.
I mean, it's brilliant that you've got these and that you've managed to convert them into, you know, digital media. Tell us a few of the little sort of stories. I mean, you were about some of the planes that you had there.
Well, the B-52, of course, was the main one. This was the big, heavy-duty bomber. And then the KC-135 that was basically a flying gas station. You've probably seen pictures of it refueling planes in flight. We had the U-2, the spy plane, which was kind of interesting. There were, you know, a series of other airplanes there, but those were the main
ones. Now, the U-2, I mean, it's, you know, everybody's heard the name in the Prof. School. They always just think of the Irish rock band. But it was kind of in its infancy in a sense, isn't it, compared to, you know, what spy planes are now. Tell us about the guy running along the runway to help get it to take off.
it's basically just a big glider. And so it's held up when it's stationary. There's two what they call a pogo stick underneath each wing, and as it takes off, they fall away. And so then when it lands, they have to have a chase car to come after it. And then when it stops, they go in and put the pogo stick under it.
And what happens if they don't get the sticks in time?
I don't know, but that they, you know, it's a multi-million dollar aircraft, and if it goes too far, it's gonna scrape the runway, and they didn't want that.
Okay, so what was your actual role, and what was your sort of day-to-day duties, and what bit of happiness did you bring to the service?
I was a USO club director from 1970, the beginning of 1970 through the middle of 1973. And basically the mission of the USO is to support the troops and to try to uplift their spirits, no matter where they may be stationed in the world. And that's basically what we did. And so we had a snack bar with, I think, the best food on base. We had great hamburgers and french fries and malts and then a pizza bar later on. And it was a place where the guys could come just to get away from the stresses of their job. One of the very few air-conditioned buildings on base. We did not have bar girls or alcohol. So it was a place where everybody from the airman to the general can come in and feel comfortable. We had comfortable chairs, and they could just like sit and write letters home or play pinochle, or we had pool tables and ping pong tables, and we did a lot of activities and so forth. Anything just kind of to raise their spirits.
All right. Now, you also had, in your time there, you had some very famous celebrities come along as well, didn't you?
Well, Bob Hope. Bob Hope came with his show.
It's about the biggest, really.
Yes, yeah. He came, and he had Lola Falana with him, and Johnny Bench, a very popular baseball player at the time. Les Brown and his Band of Renown, and that was always a big draw. Everybody always looked forward to that.
And that would, I guess, obviously lift everybody's spirits, right?
I'm sorry?
It would lift everybody's spirits.
Oh, yes.
Okay. Now, you mentioned that there was no alcohol.
Mm-hmm.
So where did the servicemen go for a drink and maybe some other forms of entertainment, if you get my drift?
You want me to tell you about Newland, right?
No, I never heard of it. I thought it was just fantastic. And nobody knows where it is now.
Really. Yes, yeah. Well, it was, I don't know if it still exists, but it was an area about 15 or 20 kilometers or miles away from U-Tapao toward Rayong. And it was basically just bars and bar girls. And I think it had been set up specifically for the military to try and keep them out of the, you know, the towns, the Sadaheep and Pattaya and so forth.
Okay. So it sort of kept them a bit closer at hand, but it wasn't there on the base.
Right.
Now, one of the, I should have asked you to bring it, one of the little props that you had, have you got it? So you show us exactly what this is.
You want to start back where you started talking?
Well, okay, so you're talking about Newland.
Right.
And this is where the servicemen would go for a drink and maybe to get some female company.
Right.
But of course, you know, there was STDs and everything, so
right.
The girls had to get checkups.
Right.
So what's the significance of this number?
So each girl had to have one of these numbers. Mm-hmm. And they had to wear this number. And so I think it was once a week, the people from the hospital, the nurses and doctors, would go down and test all the girls mm-hmm. for diseases. Mm-hmm. And if they came up positive, mm-hmm. then they would read out those numbers on the local AFRTS radio station. I was doing a radio show at that time, yeah. And so we called it U-Tapao Bingo.
Absolutely fantastic. Well, and that was in 1971, right? Or 72?
Well, 70 somewhere at some time when I was there between 70 and 73, yeah.
Well, not much changed, although I haven't heard any numbers getting read out on local radio yet. Pat, I mean, today it was just, I've never seen it so busy in there. I mean, it speaks volumes, but also I guess it shows that the expats here, you know, they either have a vested interest that's been part of their life, or it's something that they're interested in, whether the family was in the military or because of the fact that they're now living here in Pattaya.
Right. And there were actually quite a few people living in the area that were stationed back there. I think a lot of them didn't come today. I didn't realize that this was the beginning of the NFL football playoffs, so there's a game going on at the same time.
Okay. All right. Well, I guess that's more important now. Pat, absolutely great. You're going to put together some more slides. You're going to come back again in the future, right?
Well, I think so. I've got some other slides that I'm in the process of converting from the time I was a Peace Corps volunteer. That was before I worked at U-Tapao.
Okay. All right. Well, absolutely fantastic. And it's great. You know, people say to me, why don't you just go and speak to interview the people, the people who've got all this knowledge? The problem is finding these people. But right. You are one of these gems. An absolute gem here in Pattaya. Thanks very much. Okay, we're going to wind up here at the Pattaya City Expats Club at Tavern by the Sea. Great speaker today, a great topic, and there'll be more guest speakers coming up, and we'll run them and the closing titles. This is Paul and Pat saying goodbye. Bye-bye. Thank you.